There are days where I would love to be somebody else. Days where I'm fighting myself. There are days where I wish I could be a child again. Sometimes days where I wish they wouldn't last.
All right, I guess we're almost ready. This better? Good. All right. Everyone, if you can take your seats, we can begin in a bit. All right, let's get started. Good morning. Welcome to Houston Oasis, Houston secular community for over years now. We just passed our 10 years mark a couple months ago, and we're glad you're here today. We have a wonderful program for you tonight. And we're gonna get started with Ken Gaines and Wayne Wilkerson. They've played with us many times before, and he's one of my favorites here. And you can read about his biography, but I'll say briefly that he's been the TMA singer-songwriter for the year, and for the past 24 years, he's produced Thursday Night in the Round series at the Houston's legendary Anderson Fair. He's celebrating his 54th year as a professional performer now. So let's get started. Thank you. A couple songs, and then I'll introduce our speaker.
Seven months ago, I moved to Oregon City, Oregon. If you think touring Texas is a lot of driving, try to come down from just south of Portland, Oregon to here and then tour Texas and drive back. Here's a road song. Way out here on this highway, nothing else. Between the last stop and the next one down the line, it's a simpler way of living, a simpler way to see. Leaving all my worldly cares behind. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky. How everyone I love, all that I hold dear, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here. Somewhere behind me is the man I used to be, lost before I knew him as a friend. Somewhere out in front I know he's waiting there for me, as I sweep across the circle once again. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky. How everyone I love, all that I hold dear, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here.
things to bear. I lift my eyes and sing this little prayer. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky. How everyone I love, all that I hold dear, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here.
Story, and you heard it right here at the Houston Oasis.
Somehow I have a chocolate cake on my neck. I don't know. A...
And this next song is for the dancers. Y'all can even two-step to this one, I think. This one features the Texas State Chord. This is the Texas State Chord right here. Now, key doesn't matter, all right? This is a major chord. Yeah, a little bit of music magic. If you take, that's this is an F chord, F-A-C. You take that A note and you drop it down a half step. You're in a different universe. You're in the minor key. But we're going to go back up to that major key, F-A-C. You add a sixth note to that, you swangin'. Like a brand new man, I'm listening to a different band. Ever since you came into my life, hardly took a holiday. He lived without a word to say. Ever since you came into my life. Ever since I heard you speak my name, I knew I would never be the same. And ever since I gazed into those baby blue eyes, giving me a glimpse of paradise, I'm grinning everywhere I go, telling everyone I know. Ever since you came into my life, swang wang. I'm holding on with all much.
All right, thank you, Ken, Wayne. They'll be back, of course. All right, before I introduce our speaker, I want to, I'll be failing if I didn't mention our core values. These are some of values that our interactions have been guided at Oasis. Some of my favorite ones are meaning come from making a difference and human hands solve human problems. For me, it means we volunteer a lot, and you'll see more of those events coming up in your bulletins. Maybe not this week, but they'll be there soon. And please watch for events on your bulletin, and let me know if you have any questions. And we have some people in the back as well to help you. All right. So let me introduce our speaker at this point. I'm excited to introduce him here and hear from him as well. Dave Farina, or Professor Dave, that's his YouTube channel, is an American science educator and YouTuber. He has a BS in chemistry and an MA in science education. He started Professor Dave Explains, aiming to create educational videos for all subjects, and has over 193 million views in topics ranging from economics, psychology, and much more. He often tackles pseudoscience, including flat earthers, COVID conspiracy theories, young earth creationism, intelligent design. That was one of the things that brought me to the secular community, so I'm excited to hear this. Welcome, Dave.
Let's check. Awesome, thank you. Whoops, over here. Just use the arrows, okay. Also not working. Okay, I'll just do this. All right. Hi, everybody. Me here at Houston Oasis. So my name is Dave Farina. I'm a full-time science communicator. So this is still a little bit of a new, hasn't really penetrated the common vernacular yet. So I still definitely have the experience of being at a party. Someone says, "What do you do?" I say, "I'm a science communicator." Eyes go blank, they don't know what I'm talking about. I have to kind of explain it a bit. They have many follow-up questions. This is more of a science-minded group, so perhaps some of you are familiar with the concept of a science communicator. And so essentially what I do is you have the scientific community doing a lot of science. And over the 20th century and now entering into the 21st century, this incredible progress in every area of science, and the general public is left behind and have very little hope of keeping up with the frontier. Is this still working? And even in some cases, just very basic scientific information. Now the problem is the scientific community, the scientists themselves, are often too busy to explain what they're doing to the public, or simply don't possess the skill set. But the public can't be left to their own devices in terms of interpreting what is going on in the scientific. Possess the background knowledge, and so that leaves them very vulnerable to propaganda and to disinformation. And so thus enter the science communicator, or the career science communicator, such as myself. There certainly are scientists who take it upon themselves to communicate science, and that's very commendable. However, the concept of a career science communicator, I am not science. I am not busy teaching science. I spend all of my time thinking about how do I convey the activities of the community to the general public in ways that most effectively convey that knowledge, most effectively understand the purpose of what scientists are doing, and tackle any disinformation along the way. So that's what I do. The ways I do this primarily are through my YouTube channel called Professor Science, which initially just started with chemistry tutorials for students to use to help to pass their classes, and then branched off into many other different projects now, about 30 plus different subjects. But as of late, I've also become very passionate about purely debunking material, where I directly target specific frauds and charlatans and propagandists and disarm their narratives, fact check them, that sort of a thing. I also wrote a book called Is This Fire Organic, which sort of synthesizes those two aspects of the channel, whereby I provide very basic scientific information in chemistry, biology, physics, and then apply that to certain fads and trends I see in terms of the way the public is perceiving science, the ways, some of the ways that the public commonly misunderstands science. So that's what I want to talk about today, because I'm witnessing a transformation in my field. In terms of who has done SciComm historically and who is doing it. We're seeing a stark change in that, and I think it's a good thing. Why SciComm is important, and then strategies that I've discovered and have been implementing, and what we should be doing in the future. So historically speaking, SciComm is the main of So Sagan, the great demigod of SciComm, all hail Sagan. He was an astronomer. He was a prominent researcher in his field, who then later in his career decided to pivot to public outreach. And so, I'm sure many of you may remember the landmark Cosmos series, right? The PBS Cosmos series. I was a little kid when it came out, but then later, when I was in high school, I went and I got the VHS tapes from the library, and I brought him home, and I thought it was so cool. So this is what Sagan did, was he took it upon himself to convey what researchers in his field were doing and the knowledge that they had gathered, and directed his explanations toward the public. And he turned a generation of people on to space and science in general. And so that was a remarkable achievement, and I think that the batch of science communicators that followed for the subsequent couple of decades were pretty much in that vein, right? Neil deGrasse Tyson, these kinds of people who were researchers in their field that then decided to pivot to public outreach. Now we are witnessing a change where we are seeing that the skills required to make an effective science communicator are very particular. We're realizing that we need to nurture these skills earlier in the career of a young science-minded person. So we're seeing actual graduate programs appearing in science communication. So for example, this is just one of them, but UC Santa Cruz has a master's in science communication program, and there are definitely others. And so this is a situation where we are encouraging young science-minded people to get a bachelor's degree in some area of science, chemistry, physics, geology, astronomy, whatever, and then go directly into these kinds of programs where we are encouraging them to develop these skills of other aspects that make a good science communicator. And so one of the hallmarks of this approach is foregoing the typical route of specialization, getting a doctorate and becoming an expert in a tiny sliver of a subfield of one area, and being certainly a leading expert in that one tiny thing, but then foregoing the rest of the body of scientific knowledge. Now we're seeing generalism is emerging as a valuable quality for a science communicator or someone like a futurist to have, so they can do these they can have an interdisciplinary way of looking at this stuff. You want me to switch it over? Okay. So this is a very good thing because many of us have had the experience, and you know, I certainly have had the experience of being very passionate about science, being very interested in science, but not finding that I had any passion or interest in the traditional route. So in the bit of research that I did, I found that I did not enjoy it. I did not like doing research. I found it very monotonous and tedious and had no interest in doing it. And I found some passion, or at least certainly an enjoyment for teaching in a classroom setting. But ultimately it was science communication that really sparked my interest, because I found that it was a way to blend some artistry and storytelling, these other things that are not really the traditional routes. So there are many science-minded people that do get very passionate about research, and that's fantastic. They will be the next crop of brilliant scientists. But by encouraging these other skills and harnessing a new generation of career science, I think that this will be absolutely crucial for addressing some of the things that are going on in our culture today. And the main reason for that, I think that we all know the big difference in terms of our current era. We are in the information age and we have the internet. We've had the internet for a few decades now, and we are now seeing the full power of the internet in terms of the way that it shapes our epistemology, the way that that people use the internet and in particular social media to shape their own worldview. So this is the difference between our time and Sagan's time, right? When Sagan, he didn't have a bunch of flat earthers going, CGI, and you're NASA shill, and all this stuff. He made his show, and everybody watched it on TV, and it was great, right? So, but that's not the way that the landscape is these days. So with the internet, we're seeing democratization. It is no longer the case that we can hide injustice anymore. So that is definitely an immense positive aspect of it. Switch over. Okay.
Check.
Yeah.
I don't mind holding this. Oh, I gotta give you this.
So we are seeing the democratization of information, which is certainly a positive thing. However, with about 20 or 30 years of practice now, we're seeing how special interests have become increasingly effective at crafting propaganda for the specific purpose of misleading the general public and polarizing them one way or another politically. And so this is an enormous problem. This is something that I think about every day and deal with and try to come up with solutions for. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the disinformation that I found, the way I interface with it, some strategies I've come across. So the very entry level would just be sort of your run-of-the-mill snake oil salesman. So there used to be these guys that would travel from town to town and sell snake oil, and it's a cure-all for what ails you. And this has definitely become the case on the internet as well. So typically, we're talking about your fake doctors or your chiropractors that are selling supplements and these kinds of things. And anything like this is going to rely on some kind of narrative or some way of alluring the public. And I would say that naturalism is certainly a narrative that lies at the heart of some of these scams. So we're talking about people who exploit public confusion surrounding certain scientific terminology. So like, for example, natural and synthetic, these are two words that bear specifically a positive and negative connotation with the public in a way that doesn't actually correlate with what the words truly mean. So those can be used incorrectly to ensnare a viewer. The word organic has become increasingly nebulous and misunderstood by the public. Even something like the word theory and exploiting its colloquial connotation of a guess in order to misrepresent well-substantiated science. So I find that even just going through the process of rigorously defining these words for the public to help them understand their true meaning can be effective in terms of disarming some of these dishonest narratives. I just want to give you one example that I have found very amusing. You'll see, certainly L-ascorbic acid is known as vitamin C. Vitamin C is the vitamin nickname for L-ascorbic acid. They are synonymous. However, in this sphere, you will hear a narrative that that's not the case, right? That actually L-ascorbic acid, or in this case, ascorbic, I think is what he thought it was spelled, is actually just the outermost shell of this vitamin C complex, right? There are other components, and this is a shell, and you need the whole complex to get the full nutritional effect. Which sounds great, but the problem is that that's not a thing. That is completely fabricated. Does not exist. But to someone with no knowledge of biochemistry, it could seem alluring, right? The nature made this thing, and then the man-made imitation does not suffice. But how do you talk to someone without that information that feels emotionally this is an emotionally driven thing? Well, this is a situation where Google can be a friend, right? So I would say to this person, let's pretend that vitamin C complex is a thing. If you were to Google this, what would you expect to find? You would expect to find perhaps some journal articles. Somebody should be researching this thing and figuring out what it's all about. At the very least, you'd have a Wikipedia page
saying what it is in very plain, unbiased language, right? But that is not what you find. If you Google vitamin C complex, it's page after page after page of people trying to sell you things, right? So this is, I think that this is a learning experience that can have effect on some people, certainly not all. But nobody likes being swindled, right? So if you can demonstrate empirically even that you are being swindled, I think that definitely can have an effect on some people. But with naturalism, there's so much clamor about it that it takes hold of consumer trends to the point where you will see non-GMO stickers on products like salt and baking soda. Now, what could this possibly mean, right? These are not living organisms. They don't have any G's to M, right? This doesn't mean anything. But to the consumer, it means something. To the consumer, it means something emotionally. It means no science in here, right? That's what that means. But that is definitely alarming in terms of the state of things. But with everything, we've got a flip side. So you have the positive connotation of naturalism. And then the flip side of that coin is the negative connotation of fear-mongering. So fear-mongering is the other side of that, and this is a tactic that is used by any alternative industry. So this is supposed to be a depiction of GMOs in the mind of the science denier. And so what could this possibly mean? I mean, this is complete with the stitching, I think, meant to evoke Frankenstein's monster and the sentiment of the hubris of man in thinking they can mimic nature or interfere with nature. But this perfectly encapsulates that fear-mongering, because this is so utterly and incredibly unrelated to anything that the genetic modification could possibly mean. But nevertheless, fear-mongering is certainly at the heart of much of science denial, and is certainly at the heart of the intense wave of vaccine hesitancy and anti-vax sentiment that we are seeing now in the wake of COVID and the COVID vaccine. So this is, I mean, we could talk for 10 hours about this, so I'm not going to talk too much about it. But there's a few things that are important to mention, or at least in particular, one thing that this has taught me. There is a very particular tactic that science deniers or propagandists will like to use, and that is to go back in time in the history of science and identify obsolete science from the past, and then simply peddle it today as though it were still relevant, right? And so the reason they do this is because it comes ready-made. It's ready packaged with buzzwords and talking points. And so, for example, here. With this, we're going back to the 1800s, and people are reviving this concept of terrain theory. So this is something that was happening when we were still figuring out that pathogens exist and what they do, and so people will just revitalize this and peddle it as though it was something. It's current science or a competing theory with pathogens and how they operate, and so. This goes so far as to presume not only that pathogens do not cause disease, but that they do not exist. There are people that literally believe that viruses are not real. And so this is a guy, Andrew Kaufman, who runs with this. So everybody, you have this central theme, and then you have people who run with it and do their own little flavor. And this guy is saying, oh, COVID and by extension viruses in general, they're not separate entities. They're actually these outcroppings of somatic cells called exosomes. And so they're actually of human origin, and they contain human DNA. And so that's what it is. And so so then go to my website and buy all these things, because this is how it's working. So this is completely insane. I mean, one need only turn to the existence of the field of virology, right? We have thousands and thousands of people all over the world who isolate viruses, sequence their genomes, which in some cases are not even DNA, they're RNA-based. So the idea that this is somehow of human origin is absurd. We utilize medical techniques, gene therapy, right? We do things with viruses. So they certainly exist, but this is essentially like defending geocentrism, right? It's like going back, if you were in the 1400s, it wouldn't be completely ridiculous to defend geocentrism. Then the data came in and we realized that the sun is the center of the solar system. But today you can't pretend that geocentrism is valid, nor can you pretend that terrain theory is valid. But that's where we're at with the point of with science denial. We're at the point where the denial of literally an entire field of science, just flat out, is something that people will engage in favor of a narrative they enjoy. And then this obviously extends to the vaccines. You have people who are calling it gene therapy, ironically, without any knowledge of what that means. And then the amplification of the deaths, et cetera. But yeah, we don't have to. That's just too much to talk about today. One other thing that I found really amusing, because I do like to analyze the psychology behind the narratives. We do have an anti-establishment narrative operating in contradictory ways. If everybody remembers this whole ivermectin thing and people claiming ivermectin is a valid treatment here, that is an inaction of an anti-establishment narrative towards the government in response to implementing vaccines. But in doing so, they end up having a pro-pharma narrative because ivermectin was initially developed by Merck. It's a pharma giant. So they're pro-pharma in order to be anti-government, but then turn around and are anti-pharma in terms of the production of the vaccine. So there's just no consistency, but I just found that to be an amusing aspect. So now I want to pivot here. This is actually something that I'm working in more closely right now in terms of fundamentalist Christian propaganda. So Discovery Institute is a propaganda mill out of Seattle. And so their whole thing is pushing intelligent design, trying to get it into public schools. They've tried multiple times to campaign for this to be implemented in public schools. So essentially, religion in science class is the goal here. One would think, okay, that's a little bit weird, but not necessarily super threatening. This is the leaked so-called wedge document, an internal document that was leaked. It's a little hard to see, but on the very bottom left, one of the 20-year goals says to see design theory permeate our religious, cultural, moral, and political life. Right, so they do not intend to stop with what's being taught in public schools. They intend for this to be a political movement as well. And so this is actually intimately linked with the rollback on women's rights that we're seeing. So we're seeing legislation cropping up where there are those who want to make abortion punishable by death. So this is certainly alarming. And an offshoot of this is miscarriages as well. There are other legislation where they want to make miscarriage a punishable offense if they can establish intent, right? So this is where it crosses over with science, because I think that these people who are pushing for this have no clue how unbelievably common miscarriages are, let alone the idea of the complications of trying to establish intent. I'm not even sure how that could be done. But even more so where this overlaps with science, right? Despite this being political, it does interface with science, because where this hinges on is defining personhood at conception, right? But at conception, you have a zygote. It's a single cell. A single cell is not a human being. Human beings are not unicellular organisms, right? This is a preposterous thing to suggest. The logical ramification of that would be to say that removing your appendix is genocide, right? That's a lot of cells. But that is why this propaganda does not talk in terms of zygotes or blastulas or embryos or fetuses, right? This is a baby. To the Christian propagandist, that is a baby. Right, they have to use this loaded terminology because they need to evoke an emotional response, the thought of an actual human baby being murdered, somehow being equivalent to the negation of a single fertilized cell. But in the end, that's what it is, right? Does anybody watch The Handmaid's Tale? I love this show, particularly because of how scary it is, but this is what the rollback on women's rights represents, right? We're talking about the removal of civil rights under the guise of some kind of divine morality as a smokescreen for implementing authoritarian control over society, right? And so women are the easier target. As they were the last to get their rights, so too would they be the first to lose them if we were to slide back into some kind of theocratic authoritarian system. But that is why there is no aspect of this movement that shouldn't be taken seriously, right? When they're saying we want intelligent design in public school, right, which is religion in public school. We're talking about the erosion of the separation of church and state, and there is no aspect of that that should be tolerated ever. It doesn't have to escalate to the point of wanting to kill women who get abortions, right? Every single aspect of this movement, it's a slippery slope. And once you have religion in science class, you have the infringement of the church on public life and on federal affairs. And so there has to be an absolutely zero tolerance for this and swift, decisive action. The reason for this being, this has happened in other places, right? I mean, I don't know who is following along what's going on in Iran, but we have an oppressive authoritarian regime that is murdering young protesters simply for protesting. So I'm an optimist. I don't believe that America will become a Christian theocracy, but I want to be clear that anyone who thinks it is impossible, it's naive. It is possible. It can happen, right? But how does it happen? People don't just willingly give up their rights, right? But that's where the propaganda comes in. The propaganda is there to fool people into giving up their rights. So there's a lot of ways that are going on right now. As much as vaccines are big in the conversation, actually, if I'm being honest, I think that one of the central issues going on right now that is being exploited by certain factions is the conversation on gender right now. And so there's a lot of confusion among the public in terms of what gender is, what gender identity is, how that differs from sex, what trans people are, what we should be doing about the existence of trans people. And there's a lot of propaganda that exploits that and puts forward straw men like, liberals think men can have babies, and they're so stupid and ridiculous, and we're the side of science, right? Boys penis, girls vagina, that's it. There's nothing else to talk about, that's science. So they're denying science. Come over here to the rational side. And let us polarize you and propagandize you further in myriad other ways. So, if I'm being honest, it's been quite alarming to see how effective this has been in pulling centrists in that direction. So this is why there's no aspect of science that should be ignored in terms of the way the public is perceiving it, because any of these topics can be a gateway towards science denial and propaganda. So that's sort of the core of it, is that any of these things can lead towards just blanket science denial because of the public's inability to compartmentalize science, right? Those who study science or are more familiar with science have a little bit more of an ability to go, okay, these phenomena are in the domain of astronomy, these phenomena are in the domain of biochemistry, this is physics, etc., this is geology. But the public doesn't think of science that way. The public, or at least certain sectors of the public, just sort of think of science as about a dozen dudes in white lab coats in a room doing all the science. And so the problem with this is that it allows for the undermining of our trust in the scientific community through something as simple as the weaponization of the word consensus. So propagandists have trained certain sections of the public to recoil at the term consensus, right? Because what does consensus mean? What consensus is supposed to mean is that the vast majority of all people whose opinion matters at all on something agree that such and such is the case, right? So this is an enormous hurdle to overcome for the propagandists, right? We have all of these people who study this thing and know what they're talking about. They all agree on this, right? So there's no way for them to combat that on that level. They're not going to be able to come up with a bunch of peer-reviewed studies to overturn what scientists in that field are doing. So they have to go another way. They have to spin a narrative of corruption, right? And this is much easier with that primitive conception of a bunch of dudes in a room, as opposed to a vibrant scientific community of millions of people working in every country in the world, some in the private sector, some at universities, all of these different people, somehow, you know, to expect them to all be corrupt is insane. Unfortunately, popular media does exacerbate this to some extent. You're going to see a lot of clickbait titles. While all of science is wrong, all of physics is wrong, why all this stuff is wrong. And all of this is absurd. That's just not how science works. To say all of physics is wrong is just insane. It doesn't mean anything. But these are clickbait titles for a reason, because we click them. So it is very clear that this is scratching some kind of psychological itch for a large sector of the people who maybe are not completely overtly anti-science, but still harbor some kind of negative, some kind of resentment. Maybe they didn't like science class in school, and they say, well, it's actually good that I didn't learn science, because it's all wrong. It would have been a waste of time. So now I can learn the real thing, and they're now vulnerable to whoever is going to peddle them the narrative that they most enjoy. So unfortunately, the popular media, this is a ramification of capitalism, right? Clicks mean bucks. So whatever's going to get the clicks is whatever's going to get the, you know, whatever title is going to get you to click on it. It doesn't matter what the ramifications are on public opinion of science. It's just about the clicks. So this is also problematic. And so this is why, again, you know, no area of science denial should be ignored. A while ago, I think maybe 9 months ago, there was this story going around that images from the James Webb Space Telescope proved the Big Bang didn't happen, right? So this is ridiculous, but I had to hunt it down, right? So it started from this video on this clickbait channel called Future Unity, and it got millions and millions of views, and then, well, they didn't make it up. This is just clickbait, so where did they find this narrative? And it came from this guy, Eric Lerner, and he's just a plasma cosmologist, so still peddling obsolete science from about 4 decades ago. But the allure, again, right? It's this allure of the scientists had it wrong. Everything we knew about this cosmology is wrong. But the problem is that, again, because people are not compartmentalizing scientific subfields, they're saying, I knew it. The scientists were wrong about the Big Bang, and that means they're wrong about the vaccines, and they're wrong about the climate. Because, again, it's just these guys in one room. They're not conceptualizing it as an entire community of people. And so that I think, in my experience, is the singular thread that unites all science denial, is an anti-establishment narrative. You have big pharma, you have big science, whatever that could possibly mean. You have big something, that is the evil empire, and then you have the brave Luke Skywalker, you have the brave knight, you have the truth teller, you have the whistleblower, right? You have the speaking truth to power. This narrative is so alluring, it feels so good, we want it to be true so badly that many of us will suspend logic entirely simply to feel that we are either that brave rebel or are on their side, rooting them on, that they're the underdog. So that's where I see us at this current time. It is definitely a strange time, and I would be one to say that this is the premier existential challenge facing the human race, is how do we get people to know what is true? I genuinely believe that this is more urgent than climate change, more urgent than any other threat that one would think of a natural origin, another pandemic, an asteroid, anything like that, because there's no way to mobilize people towards a unified goal if everyone is confused about what reality is. Imagine if another pandemic of the magnitude of COVID or greater were to break out tomorrow or in a year or in 3 years. It would be mayhem. It would be mayhem. No one would be listening to any knowledgeable figure in any way, shape, or form. Even an asteroid, if you guys saw the movie Don't Look Up, that was a good one, and obviously satirical, but frighteningly accurate, I think, in terms of the way the public would react to that kind of a threat. Just ignore it or, you know, fall prey to propaganda, etc. So if we do not figure this out, we do not stand a chance against any threat, because we will be manipulated and divided instead of unifying towards a common goal. So if we don't figure this out, we may not see the 22nd century. And I do believe it is a war. And so how do you fight a war? Well, you need an army. You need an army. And this is why I describe the birth of the science communicator. I do not say the birth of the science communicator in terms of the first time anyone did science communication. That is not new, right? We've had science communicators over the decades. But this concept of a career science communicator whose sole purpose is to sift through what's going on the internet and in public discourse, identify the bad faith actors, call them out, identify the false narratives, fact check everything, and facilitate the process of helping the public understand what is going on scientifically. This is something that is uniquely of now, that is incredibly urgent given the media landscape and what how we now interface with reality with the internet. And that is why we need an army of such people, because there is no one singular way to communicate science to the people, because everyone has a different way of learning, right? So we need people who are communicating to different age groups, to different cultures, in different languages, on different platforms, on every platform, on YouTube, on TikTok, on the next one. Someone told me yesterday of a social media platform, and I was like, I don't even know what that is. That's a new one. I don't even remember what it's called. There's so many ways, there's so many places for misinformation to leak through and to reach people, and all of it has to be neutralized aggressively. So that's why we need an army of science communicators. That's why I feel so passionate about what I do, and that is why I do spend a fair amount of my time nurturing this interest in young science-minded people and encouraging them to pursue this as a career if they wish to as well. So thank you very much.
All right, thank you. We'll actually take a short break at this point. Let's take a 10-minute coffee break and say hi to people that you don't know here, and let's build some community, and we'll be back with more. Thank you. And also, I do want to remind everyone, we have a feedback survey in the bulletin, just a QR code on the inside of the bulletin, if you can help us with that. Thank you.
Thank you. Get a mic check.
All right, so I'm gonna start it out with a song I was working on sound check. Darkness just as far as you can throw. Poison's running around your door. Sleepy eyes will get you when you're slowing down instead. Red and yellow boys, you're just standing dead. Your soul's tied to a platform, someone's spinning it around. And you mustn't shake the driver as it burns from town to town. But their eyes so dark and restless, so you never did complain. When they show up soft and lonely and you spend the night in chains. Say my mouth is like a dusty desert boat. Sandstorms everywhere that I do go. Crawling dry and thirsty for evil visions in their heads. Red and yellow boys, you're just standing dead. Mother's pride had lasted for your first two tours abroad. The next one's fast approaching as you sing your leaving song. And she folds up so completely like a broadsheet in the wind. The baby is fighting in a war that she cannot defend. She said his chances in this life, you know, were small. And it weren't six kids in a rippling swimming pool. How he could slang his dope to children or rain bullets on their heads. Red and yellow boys, you're just standing dead.
All right, everyone. If you can take your seats, we can get started soon with the rest of the program. I'm sure everyone's having great conversations. We can continue them after the gathering as well for a bit. Let's get started. Let's get started with another song from Ken and Wayne, and before we go for Q&A, thank you.
Wayne and I are getting together now for the first time after 7 or 8 months that we haven't played, so we've done a few shows, and we keep thinking about the songs that we have done so far. This is one we haven't done yet this week. How many of you ever been to Biloxi, Mississippi? Not too many. Okay, yeah, there we go. Okay. Air Force? No? Okay. My mom's from Biloxi. And as a youngster, when I first started doing this, I was going to write a song about Biloxi. And glad I didn't, because I had some great mentors, who one especially, who wrote a song about Biloxi. And kept me from doing that. A guy by the name of Jesse Winchester, look him up. And I got to hear three of his concerts. And the last time I got to hear Jesse, I was able to get backstage and talk to him and tell him how much I loved him as a songwriter and how I hated him because he wrote that song, Biloxi, and he says, you don't like that song? I said, man, that's a great song. He says, you're from Memphis. I should have written it. He says, hey, it's been 25 years. Time for another song. I'll even give you a hint about writing a song about Biloxi. I said, what's that? He said, don't try to rhyme Biloxi. I'm tired as hell. Should have stopped along the way in some motel. See the water, catch the smell of old Biloxi. It's been so long since I left this town. Take the beach road, though it slows me down. But it's nice to know that it's all still around for me to see. Southern days, pack my bags, set my gaze on foreign shores. I chase my dreams, seize the day,
proxy. Sometimes I swear it's the only thing to do.
Thank you. Say it right, not Biloxi.
Okay, so Professor Dave is going to head to the stage, and since we're running a little bit short on time, the way we're going to do Q&A today is, if you have a question, I'll come around, ask me, and then I'll ask him as to summarize it. Give our folks in Zoom land a shout out. Our first question is going to come from Zoom.
All right, the first question is from Robert. Humans are apes. How do we sell this an important fact and make it a dominant part of the narrative?
Sorry, I did not any of that.
Sorry, humans are apes. How do we sell this important fact and make it a dominant part of our narrative?
A dominant part of our narrative in terms of biology? I'm not sure. I mean, yeah, I think it's an interesting fact. Humans are apes. I guess this is more relevant to the anti-evolutionist, anti-evolution talking points. It's an interesting, you know, to someone who would deny that because they have a visceral reaction to that, I would say, you know, are we mammals? Yes, we are. Are we vertebrates? Yes, we are. Are we eukaryotes? Yes, we are. We are apes. I think it's an important fact in terms of helping people understand. I mean, phylogeny itself is such an incredible field. I don't know. I definitely I feel like I want to do a little bit more content tackling specifically young Earth creationism and trying to attack some of those. In terms of the greater narrative, I'm not really sure what that could mean, but it is incredible how different we are from our closest relatives and the incredible gift of the intellect that we have. So, yeah.
We had a question over here first. Sure. One of the biggest scams on, like, from TV doctors is the phrase clinically proven. Can you sort of define what parameters are clinically proven?
I mean, well, that would entail clinical studies at all in the first place, which I think with snake oil is just a lie. But sure, clinical studies are used to substantiate to substantiate anything in the medical realm. I'm not sure how that would pertain to snake oil. I mean, yeah, these people who are peddling unproven treatments, there is no rigor to it in general. So randomization, sure. Yeah, double blinds and the key to prove, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, absolutely.
Our next question was, what would you personally think is a bigger priority? Deplatforming those who spread misinformation, or maybe give researchers and other science communicators better tools to explain what it is they know?
That's a good question. I mean, I think that both of those are pivotal. I mean, both of those are incredibly important. I focus more on the former just because when you have bad faith actors that spin such effective narratives and ensnare such large swaths of the public with this disinformation, it doesn't matter how much factual information you throw at them. They have devoted themselves to this particular figure, this beacon who they've elevated above all other knowledge. And so those people have to be specifically attacked and deplatformed and exposed. Not that I would ever discourage anyone from also providing the correct factual information. And everybody has a different skill set. I happen to be a little bit more pugnacious, and I like to go after the people, but some people don't. I mean, it has its drawbacks because I have a lot of pushback from those people, and it's very irritating. So if you don't want to be in that realm, I would encourage you to be one of those putting forward the accurate information. But also, I just cannot overstate, it's so crucial that we target and dogpile on these bad faith actors on every medium in which they operate aggressively and without mercy. So yeah.
And then the second part of that is, how would you personally critique or Dr. Fauci's science communication skills?
Fauci, I mean, it's, if I'm being honest, I never even really followed the things that he was saying because I was so I'm just very sensitive to, like, since he was so primary a central figure in what the government was doing, I knew that it was immediately going to be distorted at every turn by certain areas of the public. But I mean, I suspect there was probably some. Like, I think with the, like, at first, like, oh, don't use masks, but then use masks. I think some of the reason was, like, to prevent panic buying of masks or something like that. So my understanding is there was probably some miscommunication on their part. But I genuinely was never even paying attention to what Fauci was saying. I was just paying attention to just sort of keeping my finger on the pulse of the public discourse.
So I get the idea that your aim is more debunking the bad actors in the public. How much in your area of discipline do you find that they're going the other way and dealing with all the different scientific disciplines who go down their own beautiful rabbit hole and missing some of the larger pictures? Is there efforts to bring the scientific community into a much broader spectrum of our gained knowledge?
100%. I study chemistry, but I am a generalist. So the ramification of that is that I'm not an expert in any academic field. There are great benefits to being a generalist because I get because of the broader perspective I have, I can kind of synthesize different elements of a large societal issue. But given my standing between the public and the scientific community, I will always refer to experts, whether they are experts who do some SciComm, and I can reach out to them and get their input on something, or just genuinely just reaching out of the blue to experts in a particular field and saying, I need further clarity on this, or can you lend a statement to this, or can you, you know, voice your expertise in a way that is going to be pertinent and will carry weight in this thing. And so, absolutely. I mean, I want to act as almost like an ambassador of the scientific community, and I would never consider myself specifically among their ranks, but because I'm able to sort of dissect the urgency of a situation, see where it's coming from, see why people are falling for things, I think I'm in a privileged position to go, okay, I can talk to this expert, I will get that statement or have them make a statement, and that will have some impact on this particular aspect of this issue. So SciCommers and scientists will always have to work together very closely in the coming decades.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm really glad this is the last one. It might be a big one. What would you say to people who try to use quantum physics as proof of their chosen deity?
Sure, yeah. So this, I did a whole hour-long debunk on, it's called Quantum Mysticism is Stupid. In short, quantum physics is confusing, therefore it's magic. So if I want to sell someone magic, I will dress it up in the language of quantum physics, and my magic will be deemed now real or scientific. And so this can be done. I don't think that many people do it to try to demonstrate a deity existing. It's usually used to peddle some kind of energy healing or other kind of quack alt medicine things. In terms of a deity existing, I can't even off the top of my head think of how that script would go. It might even be a little more valid than the healing thing, but inevitably, no, quantum physics doesn't point to a deity per se. In short, my response would be similar to what I did in the debunk, to elucidate very basic concepts in quantum physics and to show how they are being bastardized, how they are being misused to peddle a narrative. But we see it a lot. It's everywhere. So.
Thank you, Dave. That was a good information session, and as well as the Q&A as well went well. All right. So before I get Ken and Wayne to come over for their last song, I want to mention again the feedback survey that we have in our bulletin here. The inside code is the QR code for some of our survey to understand what kind of speakers you like and who would you like to bring in. We also want to mention that Houston Oasis is a 501c3 organization, and your donations are appreciated. We can take cash donations in the back, as well as some of the more modern forms with the QR code. We have the card reader as well in the back. So all donations are appreciated, and if you can't, that's good. We are happy to see you here always, and we've been here for 10 years, and we'll be there next week too. All right, Ken, for your last song. Thank you.
We all have a lot of things we have never gotten over. And we'll never get over. This is my short list, the list that rhymes. Thank you. I never quite got over Woodstock. Or November 63. The things I learned at 21. Put a big old hole in me. Never worried much about the bar. Not a whole lot I could do. Never get over losing Mom. And I'll never get over you. Never quite forget Lee Remick's eyes. And baby, the rain must fall. And I'll never forget my baby's cries and the pain I caused them all. Never stop wanting a lover's touch and all the things that lovers do. Never stop having to feel so much. I'll never get over you. Some say that nothing lasts forever. Don't believe it's true. Love's the one thing that will never disappear from view. Become the love we keep alive after everything is through. So the only way I will survive is to never get over you. Never stop being a wandering star. Never get over you. No, I'll never get over you. Thank you so much. Great singing for you folks again.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you for coming in for another great Sunday. We will be here next week as well. And join us today for lunch at Habastian's Mexican restaurant, 8054 South Gessner. And it's about 3 miles away here. And let us know if you have any questions. Thank you.